So I'll stop my talk. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kiran sir, for this great information. Madam? Sheila ma'am? Sheila ma'am, your screen is seen completely now.
आता माझं ऐकायला येत आहे ना
आवाज पण येतो आणि दिसतंय पण छान.
थँक्यू सो मच.
थँक्यू मॅडम.
सॉरी फॉर द ट्रबल.
ओके.
एनिवे आय थिंक एज ऑल ऑफ अस वी नो दॅट स्टील पीपीएच इज अवर लीडिंग कॉज ऑफ मॅटर्नल मॉर्टॅलिटी अँड आय एम रिअली थँकफुल टू डॉक्टर अजय माने अँड डॉक्टर राजेंद्र सिंग परदेसी एज वेल एज डॉक्टर शेवाळे अँड द जालना नांदेड अँड औरंगाबाद सोसायटी फॉर गिव्हिंग मी दिस अपॉर्च्युनिटी. Now, PPH affects approximately 5% of all birthing women, leading cause of maternal mortality in low-income countries, and it is estimated that there are 10 near misses for every maternal death due to PPH. So, our fatality rate is very high. So, improving clinical skills and knowledge of the risk factors of PPH are instrumental in preventing maternal morbidity and mortality. All of us are aware of the SDG goal 3 and 5. That is to reduce the global maternal mortality ratio to less than 70 per 1 lakh live births. And I know that Maharashtra is really nearing to that. Now, there are common preventable errors. So we have to really look at errors. All of us, we know what is PPH, how to manage, how to diagnose. But what are the preventable errors? So if we look at those preventable errors, we will be able to tackle this problem. That is the under recognition of the blood loss. Lack of appropriate attention to clinical signs of hemorrhage and associated hypovolemia, failure to act decisively with life-saving interventions, and failure to restore the blood volume in a timely manner. So from the studies, we know that the error can happen under these categories. Definition, all of us are aware, for vaginal delivery, blood loss more than 500 ml, which occurs in first 24 hours. Secondary PPH is from 24 hours to 6 weeks. And we also define as massive or severe PPH when it is the blood loss is more than 1000 ml or more within the same time frame. Now, PPH can be minor, 500 to 1000 ml, major, more than 1000 ml. Again, major can be divided into moderate and severe. Moderate between 1000 to 2000 ml and severe, which is more than 2000 ml. Now, for clinical purposes, any blood loss that has the potential to produce hemodynamic instability should be considered as PPH. For example, in an anemic woman, even a 350 ml of blood loss can cause hemodynamic instability. Now, massive obstetric hemorrhage is defined as a blood loss from the uterus or genital tract of more than 1,500 ml or a rate of blood loss of 150 ml per minute or 50% of blood volume loss within 3 hours or decrease in more than 4 gram hemoglobin per deciliter or acute loss requiring more than 4 TURBTs at a time or any hemorrhage associated with hemodynamic instability. Causes, all of us are aware of the 4 T's. Now the causes of PPH in every T. Tone, previous PPH, multifetal pregnancy, grand multiparity, fetal macrosomia, polyhydramnios, failure to progress in second stage of labor, prolonged third stage of labor, fibroids and general anesthesia. In trauma, operative deliveries, perineal lacerations, even episiotomy. Tissue retained placenta, placenta accreta. We know that now we call it as a PAS, placenta accreta syndrome, according to FIGO, which is becoming a very common problem because of the rising incidence of cesarean section. Then we also face added on problem due to thrombin deficiency, that is preeclampsia, HELLP syndrome, bleeding disorders, even sepsis can lead to DIC, and if the patient is on certain drugs like aspirin or heparin. Now, there are three broad areas in which the outcomes from PPH may be improved. That is, first is prevention, then is the treatment, and the rescue. Now, prevention covers antenatal strategies, that is correction of anemia, active management of third stage of labor, and treatments for retained placenta. Now, treatment covers both medical and surgical, and rescue therapies include intravenous fluids, blood transfusions, coagulation correction, and supportive care, such as maybe compression garments or even a balloon tamponade. Now, if you look at this histogram of blood loss at delivery showing the death zone at a loss of over 40% of blood volume. So once the patient has lost more than 40%, definitely the mortality will be very high. And there are three strategies for intervention: prevention, treatment, and rescue. Okay, so we have to look at all the strategies. Now, prediction is again very important. What are the antenatal risk factors? Previous PPH, anemia, retained placenta, maternal age more than 35 years. BMI, body mass index, is more than 35 kilogram per meter square. And all of us, we know that obesity is on the rise. Gram-multiparity may be on the reduction side. Antepartum hemorrhage, overdistension of uterus, and pre-existing uterine anomalies. Now, what are the risk factors in labor? Induction of labor, prolonged first, second, or even third, even first stage prolonged, second stage or third stage. Secondary arrest of labor, especially in multigravid patients, use of oxytocin, precipitate labor, operative delivery, or cesarean section. Now, prevention of PPH, the patient safety bundle is a set of straightforward evidence-based recommendations for practice and care process known to improve the outcomes. So the consensus bundle on obstetric hemorrhage is organized into four domains. We have to remember these four domains. One is readiness, recognition, and prevention. And then comes the response and reporting and system learning. Now, this system learning is very important, you know, because suppose if we are in an institution and we are facing this problem, though we have to learn that what is happening in this system. And for under all this, there are 13 key elements within these four action domains. That is for readiness, recognition, and prevention, response, reporting, and system learning. Now, readiness, every unit, hemorrhage cart with supply, checklist, and instruction cards for even intrauterine balloon and compression stitches. Immediate access to hemorrhage medication. So we should be ready with the kit, which contains all the oxytocin, including the tranexamic acid. You have to establish a response team, that is who to call when the help is needed. The blood bank number should be flashed in the labor room as well as in the OT. You have to have a support of the advanced gynecological surgery like oncosurgeon. Sometimes you may need a urologist also. Other support and tertiary services like HDU and ICU. You have to establish MASU and emergency release transfusion protocols. Why? Because suppose you need a blood and the patient is in a class 4 hemorrhage, there is no time to cross-match the blood. In that case, you should tell the blood bank to release the O negative uncross-matched blood, because you know you don't have the fear of any uncross-matching or anything, and the patient is almost going to sink if you do not transfuse blood in time. So every blood bank in a tertiary care center must have obstetric unit, particularly O negative blood, kept ready. Unit education and protocols and unit based drills with the post drills debrief, that during the drill, what went right and what went wrong. Just to share with you regarding this type O negative blood, you know, I was in Canada and I was traveling to Stratford. They have the same names there. And then I asked my niece, who is a doctor there, that how is the obstetric unit in this place, which is such a small, but all rich people stay there. She said, yes, they deliver here only. And one of my classmate who is MBBS, who is working there, I said, they don't mind. She said, yes, they don't mind. If there is a problem, there is a general surgeon who comes and help her. And all the time, O negative blood is stored. So anybody bleeds, we give O negative and then airlift the patient. So the lesson I learned from that readiness for this unit, what is their readiness? So that is how we have to look at our unit, that how we have kept ourselves ready. So that is readiness. Then the recognition and prevention. Assessment of hemorrhage risk, which we have done antenatally, we should do again on admission for every patient. Recognition. Measurement of cumulative blood loss, formal and as quantitative. So we have to train our staff. And active management of third stage of labor, I don't have to talk. Everybody is practicing. Now, once we have diagnosed our response, the unit standard stage-based obstetric hemorrhage plan with checklist should be ready. And there should be even a support program for the patients, families, and staff. Even patients coming to government hospitals are very smart. we have to talk to them, we have to communicate with them. Reporting and system learning. Establish a culture of huddles for high-risk patient and post-event briefs. Very important. Multidisciplinary review of serious hemorrhages for system issues and monitor the outcome and the process metrics in perinatal quality improvement, even perinatal quality. So recently I was sent by the family welfare department to one of the district hospital in Karnataka because they found that during the pandemic time, the number of cases of PPH are going up. And that was like a system learning procedure. And I really felt happy. And I learned so much in the bargain when I was discussing, because if we have debriefing, people don't get scared, you know, we don't have to call it as an inquiry. Now the readiness. Now coming to the readiness domain includes 5 areas of focus to be addressed by every facility to prevent delays and to prepare for the optimal management of obstetric hemorrhage cases. Now the readiness aims at even improving the interdepartmental coordination, very important. So it should comprise of a sterile tray with rapid access to medicines and instruments so as to deal with emergency hemorrhage situation. It is also valuable for the cart to contain cognitive aids for infrequently performed technical procedures such as placement of uterine tamponade balloon and compression suture. Recently, I heard Dr. Glay from Pravaranagar, you know, who is using this compression sutures, you know, and how he has educated the people around his district and in the district and how it has built with the PPH bundle to reduce the morbidity and mortality. Now, we have to store these drugs along with your tranexamic acid, okay? You should have 10 units of oxytocin because you may have to give 10 to 40 units per 500 to 1000 ml solution and should be kept ready. You should have a ergometrine, okay, at least 4 ampules, isoprostol 5 tablets and methyl carboprost almost 8 ampules. Now, for a vaginal delivery, and if there is a trauma, you should be ready with vaginal retractors, long weighted speculum. Now, most of the time, if we are not ready with our traumatic PPH tray, what happens? You will have to open 2 and 3 DNC sets, pick up the speculums, because this point. See, what is important is the golden hour. You do not want to waste time. It could be traumatic PPH, patient will bleed profusely. So you should have long instruments, long needle holders, scissors, and even Kelly's clamp, sponge holders, intrauterine balloon, Banjo curate, bright task light, and procedural instructions also. Caesarean laparotomy, hysterectomy tray should be ready. All suture materials required. Reloadable straight needle for bilinge because you need a bigger needle. Intrauterine balloon. If you have Bakri balloon, fine. Procedural instructions also should be there, namely balloon, bilinge, and arterial ligation. Recently, I heard Dr. Maria from Colombia, you know, in their assessment, they found that the most of the time, the people are not aware of how to do the balloon tamponade and how to do this surgical sutures. So you have to establish a response team, determine who will be the part of the core response team. Suppose if you are the obstetrician, you will have to take a helicopter view of the situation, okay? And you will have to communicate with your team. So primary maternity care provider and nurse, clinicians from anesthesiology, transfusion service, pharmacy, advanced gynecological surgery, critical care medicine people, the main operating room, even an interventional radiology and additional nursing resources. Now, readily available phone or page numbers or a rapid response or a code system in case of an emergency. And I always say that we should have a H code in labor room because H is related to hemorrhage, to hypertension also, which are the commonest causes, or whatever code system you have or a buzzer, because your response team should be ready and they should know that there is a patient who is bleeding in the labor room and everybody is available. You have to establish massive and emergency release transfusion protocols. Now, a massive transfusion protocol facilitates rapid dispensing of RBCs, plasma, and platelet in a predefined ratio, intended to preclude the development of a DIC that can result if a significant percentage of patient blood volume is replaced is large quantities of crystallite, colloid, or RBC. Suppose if you don't have the blood products ready, that is FFP and platelets, and you go on giving only crystallites or colloid or only PRBCs, your patient will go into dilutional coagulopathy because there will be a washout phenomenon. So we should be ready with the transfusion protocol. As the volume is replaced, attention must be paid to coagulation parameters, platelet count, and metabolic status. Very important. If your patient is in class 4, immediately get an ABG done. Because if your patient is into acidosis, you will have to correct. Because in spite of correction, in spite of giving blood also, your patient will not come out and she will go into irreversible shock. So acidosis or metabolic status also should be given equal importance. There are no rational guidelines for activating the massive transfusion protocols. And the criteria are varied and include when patient is actively bleeding and any of the following. So we can follow systolic blood pressure less than 90, pH less than 7.1, base deficit is more than 6 milliequivalent per liter, temperature below 34 degrees centigrade, hypothermia, very important. Immediately see to it that your patient is not having hypothermia. INR more than 2. You know, and platelet count less than 50,000 per cubic millimeter. Now, you will take time to receive your coagulation profile report. What we can do is immediately you do the clot observation test. I know the Nanded Society is there, and you know the professor has taught all of you, and I was in Nanded, Dr. Mahale, so beautifully he explained how to look at the clot and the clot observation and how it helps us to diagnose DIC. Blood bank to issue 6 units of PRBC, 6 units of FAP and 6 units of platelet and 10 units of cryoprecipitate also in case of massive transfusion. Hemorrhage drills. So you need to do the drills. A drill refers to a clear and logical set of steps involved if in the patient management. All team members are familiarized with entire safety bundle and new management plan. Participating members are assigned the tasks and responsibilities necessary to run the drills. And post-drill debriefing provide an invaluable opportunity to learn from the experience, specifically to enforce the areas of drill that went well. Discuss areas in need of improvement. For example, how much time was required to diagnose PPH? How much time was required to start the blood transfusion? How much time was required to get the blood from the blood bank? How much time to start the medication? And you have to highlight the system issue to allow for concrete planning for potential solutions. For example, if you take 20, 30 minutes to diagnose PPH, you're losing golden hour. It should be less than 10 minutes. Okay. You should once you have diagnosed PPH, immediately you should be starting the medical management. So drills may be combined with practicing infrequently used hemorrhage technical skills like placing a tamponade balloon or compression suture and using simple aids. Recognition and prevention. Every patient. Assessment of hemorrhage risk on admission, every patient. It helps to improve the readiness, allows increased surveillance and early recognition and the use of preventive measures and prepare the team to initiate an early aggressive response to bleeding. Risk assessment should be considered at multiple time points during patient care, including antepartum, on admission to labor and delivery, and late in labor. Now, these are the parameters, the clinical parameters to be assessed. Very important. Yes, we will be measuring all the parameters, pulse rate, blood pressure, respiratory rate, systolic blood pressure. Less than 80 millimeters of mercury is associated with a worsening tachycardia. Altered mental status is indicative of PPH of more than 1,500 ml clinically. Rule of 30. If there is a fall in systolic blood pressure of more than 30, pulse rate increases by 30, urine output less than 30 ml per hour, hematocrit is decreased by 30%. That means the amount of blood loss is more than 30%. And if you say that the blood loss is more than 30%, that comes into class 3 hemorrhage. Shock index, very, very, very simple. Pulse rate divided by systolic blood pressure. If it is more than 1, it indicates your patient is in shock. Normal shock index is 0.5 to 0.7. 0.9 indicates hypovolemia. You will have to ask for 2 pints of cross-match blood. 1.2 is again indicative of 30% of blood loss. More than 1.7, your patient has already lost more than almost 2000 ml. And this is the assessment of stages of shock. 15% blood loss, less than 15%, class 1, heart rate will be less than 100 or will remain the same. Systolic blood pressure will be normal, pulse pressure will be normal or slightly increased. Capillary refill, you can just palpate the palm of the patient and just see the capillary refill will take less than 3 seconds. Respiration will be normal, but patient will be anxious. Treatment, immediately you have to start crystalloids 1 or 2 liters and maintenance. Class 2, 15 to 30% pulse rate will be more than 100. You may find systolic blood pressure is normal, but there is a drop in the diastolic blood pressure. And also when you the patient is shifted to the ward, there could be a fainting attack because of the postural drop in the blood pressure. Pulse pressure decrease. Capillary refill may take more than three seconds. Respiration may be between 20 to 30. Patient will be very anxious. Immediately you give 2 liter crystalloid and arrange for two pints of PRBC for class 2. Because you don't want the class 2 to become class 3. Class 3, 30 to 40% tachycardia. Systolic is reduced. Pulse pressure is reduced. Capillary refill will be more than 3 seconds or absent. Respiratory rate more than 30. Patient will be confused. So immediately you have to give crystalloids in the ratio of 1:3. If the patient has lost 1,000 till the blood arrives, give up to 3,000 ml. Okay. And you have to ask for the blood transfusion. Crystalloids, you can give colloid also. And you have to ask for blood products in the ratio of 1:1:1. In class 4, you should ask if you have the facility for O-negative blood. And you will ask the blood bank to give you 6 PRBCs, 6 platelets, and 6 6 PRBCs, 6 platelets, and also you can ask them even to give you cryo. Coming to the risk assessment, prenatal, if you have suspected previa, creta, increta, percreta, you will have to plan it accordingly. Never to operate in a small nursing home. Pre-pregnancy BMI more than 50, she is at a risk. Clinically significant bleeding disorder, she is at a risk. And other medical and surgical risk. On admission, you have to classify whether she has a medium risk or a high risk. Medium risk, prior cesarean itself is a medium risk, or a uterine surgery, or multiple laparotomies, multiple gestation, multigravida, prior obstetric hemorrhage, large myoma, baby weight more than 4,000 grams, obesity, and hematocrit less than 30 and other ways. Patient has already bled, suppose in case of PPH, she has already reduced her hematocrit. High risk, placenta previa, low-lying placenta, suspected accreta, percreta, platelet count less than 70,000 will be a high risk, active bleeding, known coagulopathy, and two or more medium risk factors. If two or more, she becomes high risk. Intrapartum, medium risk, chorioamnionitis. If you have used prolonged oxytocin even for induction of labor for more than 24 hours, prolonged second stage, and if the patient is on magnesium sulfate. High risk, new active bleeding, two or more medium risk factors on admission and or intrapartum. So what is important? I said the first, third slide that there are some errors happening. Where does the error happens? The measurement of blood loss. Now, visual estimation of blood loss, sometimes called a glance and a guess, is common practice, but can result definitely in underestimation of blood loss by 33 to 50%, particularly when the large volumes are lost. So direct measurement of blood loss can be accomplished by two complementary approaches. The easiest to initiate is to collect the blood in calibrated underbutton drips for vaginal birth. That is, we have the brass V drip, or even you can just take your whatever plastic apron we are using. Okay. You take it and you seal it on one side. If you don't have the, you have the candle and seal it. You know, so many times we close the plastic covers, seal it and put it under the patient. Okay. And you can put a marks on that. Then the same and calibrated canisters for cesarean birth. Now you have a suction apparatus during cesarean. If you have aspirated the amniotic fluid, look at that, how much is the volume, and later on you just check how much blood is getting collected. The second approach is to weigh the blood-soaked items and clots and weigh of dry pads and subtracting from the total weight to obtain an estimated of blood loss. Okay. Now these are the methods and material used. Even you use a small swabs, you know, of 10 centimeter into 10 centimeter, completely soaked is 60 ml. Even during episiotomy, you may be using so many, putting it into the bucket. Medium 13 to 30, 140 ml. Large 45 into 45, 350 ml. 1 kg soaked swab, almost estimate is 1000 ml blood loss. Kidney dish full of clots, 500 ml. If there is a floor spill of 550 centimeter, it is 500 ml. 75 centimeter floor spill is 1000 ml. 100 centimeter is 1500. PPH bleeding limited to bed less than 1000. It is flowing down. Definitely, it is more than 1000. Active management of third stage of labor. All of us, we know. Okay. But we are just going to learn some new drug also at the end of it. And it can prevent the atonic PPH in 60 to 70% of the cases. Now, this is the WHO recommendation for the active management of third stage. Only practice should be by the skilled provider. I know all of us, we know that. I will not go into the details. Oxytocin is the drug of choice currently by the WHO. And now the new drug which has been introduced is the carbetocin. At the end of my talk, I'll be talking about that. And where there are no facilities to store the oxytocin, misoprostol is the drug of choice, 600 microgram orally when the patient is at the periphery where there are no facilities to store the oxytocin. Now, coming to the response. Obstetric hemorrhage emergency management plan, a critical initial step is to determine the etiology. 40s, stage-based management plans have been formed to facilitate and organize a stepwise response to blood loss and maternal warning signs. Maternal warning signs like shock index and the vital parameters. And they ensure that resources are not wasted while each patient receives optimal therapy. Each institution needs to adjust the plan to meet its individual capabilities. Okay. So checklist. Stress zero means you have to activate the hemorrhage protocol. Assess the risk factor. Estimate the blood loss, AMTSL for every patient. If she is a high risk, means still the patient has not developed PPH. You have to already send and type and keep the cross match. Okay. Low risk also type and screen. Type and screen, but high risk you arrange. In stage one, where there is a advanced thorough medication and procedure finding cause and treatment visualization, estimated blood loss is stage one hemorrhage. Okay, immediately you assess all the vitals which are normal. We discussed, we saw the hemorrhagic hemorrhage shock table. Immediately start a big bore cannula. Has to be 16 gauge. In 16 gauge cannula, you are transfusing fluid per minute 180 ml. Okay, with 18 gauge, it is only 100 ml. So there is an 80 ml this difference. Immediate fundal massage, bimanual compression, whatever you do, increase your oxytocin dose and type and cross match 2 units of PRBCs and transfuse in stage one. Okay. Where there is a 15 to 30% blood loss. In stage two, you will have to mobilize more support, blood bank, keeping the check of volume and blood products. You ask whether FFP is there, where platelets are there. Okay. And you are using again another uterotonic because only one uterotonic is not going to help. You have drawn the blood for all the investigations, including your coagulation profile, if facilities for fibrinogen, or you do your clot observation test, trauma, repair. You can place an intrauterine balloon. Okay. If you have the facilities, selective embolization. If it is a cesarean, we have the advantage of doing the compression sutures. Even we can place the intrauterine balloon. We can do placental bed suturing and stepwise devascularization depending on the condition. You have already arranged for a 2 units of PRBCs. Consider thawing more. Whenever you give more than 2 units of PRBCs, you should immediately ask the blood bank to give 2 units of FFP. 2 units of PRBCs giver, patient will definitely need more if she's bleeding. Ask for 2 FFPs, okay? And check availability of additional RBCs and coagulation products like cryo. In stage three, activate your massive transfusion protocol. Okay, you have, you know the condition now, your capillary refill, your shock index is definitely more than 1 point. You will have to mobilize your whole team. The gynecologist, you may need an intensivist, you may need an onco person to do the internal iliac artery ligation, central line insertion, family support, surgical management, supportive compression, and apply anti-shock garment. Transfuse aggressively. Okay, here it is 6-4-1, but the newer trend is 1:1:1:1. Now the newer is 1:1:1:1. That means we are also giving importance to cryo. Okay, if we have asked for 6 units of PRBCs, 6 units of platelets, 6 units of FFP, you also ask for 6 units of cryo, even 6 to 10. That is the newer thing. And now there are studies coming where they are using cryo even earlier when the patient is bleeding profusely. Support program for patients, families, and staff. Women and their families need timely information, reassurance, and opportunities to discuss the incident with the maternity care provider. Somebody asked me, when do you take the consent for compression suture? I said, if you know that she is a high risk, where you are anticipating PPH, you have already taken a risk concern, you have already explained it. But if it is unanticipated on table, then you will have to go and talk to the relatives. Now, the important is reporting and system learning. Establish a culture of hurdles and debriefs. We have to call it as a just culture. This is not an inquiry. Need to be routine. Multidisciplinary review of serious hemorrhages. And the purpose of these reviews is to identify the system issues or breakdowns that influence the outcome of the event. Review should be sanctioned by the facility, protected from discovery in legal proceedings, and include a thorough record review, event timeline, and focused root cause analysis. And monitor the outcome and the process metrics, because it is important for the successful introduction of quality improvement projects. And the overall goal is to reduce the number of obstetric hemorrhages that escalates into major blood loss, resulting in severe morbidity and mortality. I know all of you are aware now we have the Lakshya initiative, and all of us are working towards that. Very important is technical skills. Okay. Now, the UK prompt model of evidence-based multidisciplinary training is recognized to improve the neonatal outcome and has reduced the local litigation claims by 91%. Training workshops to improve the knowledge of PPH can be achieved by didactic teaching and simulation training. And standardized courses include, these are all abroad, but as all of you say, I'm a PPH lady, I really, you know, I thought it is so important and developed the module and trained many people. And evidence-based memory aids can be taught to facilitate recall of fundamental treatment steps in PPH, have been shown to reduce the chances of peripartum hysterectomy. A stepwise is evidence-based, but will definitely avoid the hysterectomy. The importance of communication amongst members of the management team should also be emphasized. And simulation training for obstetric hemorrhage, like non-technical skills also, communication, teamwork, and leadership. Now, you know, in the new curriculum, the communication is with the undergraduates, which we are always lacking, and we always learn over a period of time during our PG. So individual medical professional, what you have to look at, the knowledge and experience always counts. And then comes the expertise, situational awareness, you know, the sixth sense, communication skills, and understanding of team members. The patient, what is important is maternal safety, maternal satisfaction, and parent and family support, equally important. So you need a multidisciplinary team. All of us, we know. As a leader, delegation of tasks, appropriate team members, close-lip communication, and flattering of hierarchy. We should forget that. Infrastructure, yes, you should be ready. Suppose if yours is a CSC, there should be a blood storage facility. If you are in a nursing home, you should have a liaison with the nearing blood bank so that they don't refuse to give you blood. You should have a liaison, or you should be attached as a visiting at least to HDU, because it is the need of the hour, or ICU, where you can immediately shift the patient, you know. I am attached to a tertiary care center, which is only 1.5 kilometer, you know, and they always say whenever Sheila madam is there in labor room, means we know that there is a patient who is really critical, and everybody comes running. Simulation training we discussed, intrapartum assessment and antenatal assessment also we discussed. Prevention and management of PPH for home birth, I will not discuss because we are not promoting that. Earlier it was the TBA, but if the patient delivers in a periphery, the ASHA workers are there who can give them prophylactically misoprostol and really prevent blood loss. Then the facility treatment. It all depends on what type of facility you are there. Staffing, for example, you are in a CSU or where you can give only BMOC, a nurse aide, midwife, clinical officer, and doctor. Midwife, clinical officer, general doctor. Okay, district hospital you will have. Regional, excuse me, Priyanka. Are you changing? No. Regional or tertiary should have a midwife, general doctor. You have to have a specialist obstetrician, other disciplines also, delivery facility plus inpatient stay, blood bank, operation theater, everything should be there in a tertiary care. So if we look at this, what you do in every facility, if we are in a nursing home, we are doing the fluid resuscitation, we are starting a big bear cannula, immediately apply the anti-shocker. Okay. Immediately apply. Okay. You will ask for the blood transfusion. You will send somebody to get the blood, or, and also the FAP and the clotting factors depending on, but NSG will definitely play a very big role. Okay. And depending on the condition, you will manage. Now coming to another drug, which will help you. So dear friends, what is important in the management of PPH is the timely action. So I just discussed about those 13 points and those four headings where we have to manage all of our patients to see to it, not only the mortality, but even morbidity also should be less, because in developing countries for one mortality, there are 20 morbidities, you know, and that talks about our health system. Now coming to carbetocin, I think I will directly go to the slides which are provided by them. Before that, non-pneumatic anti-shock garment, life-saving first aid service, controls the bleeding, reverses shock, stabilizes patient condition to enable the transfer to higher center. Even you can use it in a tertiary care center also, okay? NSG is a lightweight neoprene garment that is made up of 5 segments, which that close tightly with Velcro. And it applies pressure to the lower body and abdomen, thereby increasing the venous return and stabilizing the vital signs and resolving the hypovolemic shock. You will find that the patient pulse was not palpable, blood pressure very low. You apply, immediately you will find that the vitals are improving. And it also applies the 5th segment with the ball, direct pressure on the uterus, fundus of the uterus, thereby reduces bleeding, acts like autotransfusion. And WHO has recommended this in low resource setting because it is cost effective and reusable. Okay, so there are 5 segments. You have to close the first segment around the ankles, second segment around the each calf, third around the each thigh. And the advantage is it leaves the knees free. So you can put the patient in lithotomy position. We can do suturing. We can do remolar placenta. We can do bimanual compression. Close the segment 4 around pelvis. With the pressure ball is the fixed segment over the umbilicus, and closing NSG using the segment 6. Now 1, 2, 3 can be applied by 2 persons because they are on the limbs, but 4, 5, 6 should be applied by 1 person. Okay. Now coming to the newer drug, that is carbetocin. Now the PPH after cesarean deliveries, let us see whether it is more useful there. The cesarean deliveries have become an epidemic in India, and almost they have recorded 300% jump in last decade. The incidence of PPH are high in cesarean deliveries than in vaginal. Here in cesarean 6.7, in vaginal delivery 2 to 4%. So more likely to happen after cesarean as compared to vaginal delivery, and almost 36% of cesarean deliveries are complicated by PPH. My dear brother Ajay Mane will definitely agree with me that maximum medico-legal cases are also due to PPH, that to PPH following cesarean. And therefore it is common practice to give a uterotonic drug following delivery of the neonate, even after during cesarean. The international consensus statement on the use of uterotonic agents during cesarean section, uterotonic agents like oxytocin or carbetocin are recommended for routine administration immediately after delivery of the fetus during cesarean section to prevent postpartum hemorrhage. Now, it is essential during cesarean section and in the third stage of labor for vaginal delivery to diminish the risk of PPH and improve the maternal safety. Okay, so what are they? Posterior pituitary hormones or analogs are oxytocin and carbetocin. Alkaloids, all of us we know, ergometrin and methylergometrin, and prostaglandins are PGE2, misoprostol, and carboprost. So the oxytocin, that is posterior pituitary hormones, are the first line agents, and all other are second line agents. Okay, so. And oxytocin is considered as a gold standard for the prevention of PPH. But if we look at the action now, it is short acting, half-life of 4 to 10 minutes, duration of action 15 to 20 minutes, and it must be administered for a continuous effect as a continuous IV to attain sustained uterine activity throughout the surgical procedure and immediate postpartum. Okay? Oxytocin is used for induction or augmentation and may desensitize the oxytocin receptors, thereby impairing the oxytocin's post-delivery effect on uterine contractility. Now, various international bodies and the trials have used recommended different doses of oxytocin. Thus, there is no consistency in dose regimen, which results in error in administration. I will not agree exactly with the error. But all of us, we know that we always worry that how much can I give? How much maximum can I give? You know, over a period of 24 hours when the patient continues to bleed. You know, we are not supposed to give it more than 80 units in 24 hours because it also has an antidiuretic action. It is a high alert medication. And if it is given IV, That is why it is high alert medication, meaning minor errors can cause significant harm to patient. So whenever we give a IV bolus or something like that, there has to be somebody at the head end. And most of the time that is given during cesarean section. And we have the advantage of having anesthetist at the head end. If we look at the carbetocin, it is longer acting. Single dose of administration, no variation in dosage regimes. Divide of repeated administration, so ease of one-time administration. Superior efficacy or similar efficacy as that of oxytocin. Divide of receptor desensitization, superior in side effects profile over oxytocin. Now, what is it? It is a synthetic analog of human oxytocin with some structural modification as shown below. Difficult to understand this pharmacology, but we know that these structural modifications increases the half-life of carbetocin, thereby prolonging its pharmacological effects. Now, it has been also added to WHO essential medicine list of uterotonics for the prevention of excessive bleeding after childbirth. It is still not there in our guidelines, but it is there in WHO, and it has been used in Europe and in Canada. Okay, so these are the recommendations, efficacy and safety of uterotonics for PPH prevention. The use of an effective uterotonic for the prevention of PPH during the third stage of live birth is recommended for all births. Okay. And only one of the following should be used as a primary thing. Oxytocin, recommendation 1.1. Carbetocin also. And misoprostol comes as 1.3. Ergometrine and methyl 1.4. And combination is 1.5. So the first is oxytocin and carbetocin. Okay. IV oxytocin is recommended for the prevention of PPH for all births. Sorry, IM. The use of carbetocin, again, IM or IV is recommended for prevention of PPH for all births in context where its cost is comparable to other effective. So the cost factor comes here. The use of misoprostol is recommended for the prevention of PPH for all births. The use of ergometrine, IM or IV is recommended for the prevention of PPH in context where hypertensive disorders can be safely excluded prior to its use. And the use of fixed dose of combination, again, combination of oxytocin and ergometrine is not available with us, so we are not using specific recommendation. And prostaglandins are not used as primarily, but definitely they are used for therapy. So carbetocin is recommended by WHO as an effective uterotonic in its 2018 guidelines. And carboprost is not a primary, but it is used for therapeutics. Now, half-life for carbetocin is 10 folds higher than oxytocin, 40 minutes, 4 minutes. Duration of action, it was found that a single IV bolus injection of carbetocin was at least as effective as 16 hours of continuous oxytocin infusion. There is no need to repeat the administration, no dose variation. A single dose of carbetocin is found to be effective in controlling PPH, unlike oxytocin. Oxytocin, we will have to give multiple or IV continuous infusion. So carbetocin is superior over oxytocin with respect to its pharmacokinetic parameters and single dose administration. How it works?
A postpartum hemorrhage, or PPH, is an obstetrical emergency affecting an estimated 10% of all live births. It is the most preventable cause of maternal death. The uterine arteries pump 500 to 700 milliliters per minute into the site at which the placenta is attached to the uterus. After birth, this blood could potentially flow into the uterine cavity.
I think I will go ahead because I have already discussed everything about PPH. Okay.
The myometrium contracts firmly, compressing the blood vessels and thereby reducing blood flow. A cesarean delivery can increase the risk of PPH developing.
Lay on head, shoulders, knee.
Specifically targets uterine avenue. Carbetocin is administered as a single intravenous injection. After injection, carbetocin is in this way, a signal cascade is started. As a result, the smooth muscle cells of the myometrium start contracting regularly. This causes the leaking blood vessels in the uterus to be contracted. The overall effect.
So carbetocin has been studied throughout the world, Europe, America, Asia, and Africa. Management of third stage of labor during vaginal delivery, there are clinical trials, and even prevention of PPH following cesarean delivery also, there are clinical trials. Now, following cesarean delivery, this was in 2016, a randomized control trial comparing it with misoprostol and oxytocin for the prevention of PPH. There were 263 patients with a singleton pregnancy scheduled for an elective cesarean delivery. Salbutamol 100 microgram IV was given. Oxytocin group, 10 units IV oxytocin following neonatal delivery, and 20 units in 500 ml saline was given over 4 hours, and misoprostol only 400 sublingually. Outcome primary, which were assessed, were occurrence of a uterine atrophy and necessitating additional uterotonic. The results, if you find, in carbetocin group, additional uterotonic was required only in 6%, oxytocin 13 and misoprostol 22. Blood loss is comparable with oxytocin and carbetocin, slightly more with misoprostol. Okay, bleeding between 500 to 1000 ml in carbetocin 20%, in oxytocin higher, misoprostol still higher. And requirement of blood transfusion also was more with oxytocin and misoprostol. But there were no significant differences regarding side effects between oxytocin and carbetocin. And side effects are highestly, we know that we may not be with 400, but we do find side effects, that is chills and all that, with misoprostol. So additional uterotonics were needed less frequently by patient treated with carbetocin compared to other two. This was a comparative study between effects of carbetocin and oxytocin on isoflurane-induced uterine hypotonia in twin pregnancy patient. That means the general anesthesia was used. And they found the comparison again, the outcome were need for additional uterotonics like ergometrine, blood loss, and requirement of blood transfusion. A profound difference between carbetocin and oxytocin. This was a twin pregnancies, and need of additional uterotonics was very much less with carbetocin, almost 13%, and there it is 83%. Blood loss again, very less with carbetocin, 430, here 720. Patient requiring blood transfusion also only 3 with carbetocin and 13 in oxytocin. So single dose carbetocin appears to be more effective. Prevention of PPH following cesarean delivery, another study, carbetocin versus sublingual misoprostol plus oxytocin infusion for prevention of PPH at cesarean section. Again, with risk factors, a randomized and open trial study. 380 patients with risk factors during cesarean. Comparison, outcome measures, need for additional, this was oxytocin with misoprostol, okay? And oxytocin was given 10 units IV after surgery, and misoprostol 400 before surgery. Outcome, need for additional. Estimated blood loss, incidence of blood transfusion, and definitely the additional uterotonics, because the misoprostol was added, not much difference. Blood loss also, not much difference, but the requirement of blood transfusion was more with the oxytocin with misoprostol, and shivering and fever were the side effects with misoprostol. So they found again that the only carbetocin is even better than combination of oxytocin and misoprostol. So this was the another study again. Again, the outcome measures were uterine tone, need for additional oxytocins, again for elective cesarean delivery. Results, oxytocin, ergometrine need was more and carbetocin was less. Here the ergometrine was combined. Carbetocin definitely fairly did well. Okay, and no need for additional oxytocins. This was again another one where again they assessed the comparison with methyl ergometrine. Same thing was assessed. Duration of third stage, side effects, postpartum blood loss. Carbetocin was profoundly almost 50% compared to methyl ergometrine. So it's a preferable drug in the reduction of postpartum blood loss and more safety in side effects of drugs than methyl. All of us, we know that blood and blood products are easily not available. Most of our women are anemic, and even minimal blood loss can also give rise to so many problems to them. This was the Cochrane review, author's conclusion. For women who undergo cesarean section, carbetocin resulted in a statistically significant reduction in the need for therapeutic uterotonics compared to oxytocin. And carbetocin is associated with less blood loss in the prevention of PPH for women who have vaginal deliveries and is associated with significantly fewer side effects. Okay, so this was, there are so many multiple studies where they have assessed, and they found that postoperatively pain in the day of surgery in carbetocin group was significantly lower than in oxytocin group and significantly remained till the third day. And in the day of surgery of the first day, women of carbetocin group who needed analgesic drugs were significantly lower than the women of oxytocin group. So a single injection is efficacious and safe on maintenance of uterine tone and on the limitation of blood losses, even in pain operative period. In addition, carbetocin was able to reduce the pain perception during post-operative days, improving the quality of life of women. Again, there are multiple trials which will always tell you that in comparison with blood loss, in comparison with additional oxytocins and everything, carbetocin was found to be a superior alternative to oxytocin because of its long life and an unique injection, whereas oxytocin requires repeated injections. Okay. The only concern in our country is about heat stable. We want a heat stable carbetocin. And I think they are looking at that right now. The recommendations for carbetocin are still we have to store it in refrigerator because maybe we will require larger studies, because I had a discussion with this company people. So the government of India recommendation is still to store it as oxytocin only. Okay. Now comparing with preeclampsia, carbetocin 100 microgram with Ringer lactate solution injected directly into the vein over 2 minutes. And here 20 units in 1 liter of Ringer lactate administered intravenously at a rate of 125 ml per hour. And the primary outcome measures were requiring additional uterotonics, secondary difference in hemoglobin levels between the groups, development of oliguria, hemodynamic status, that is MAP and heart rate after administration of the drugs. Okay, and this is the comparison that carbetocin is an appropriate alternative to oxytocin for the prevention of PPH, even in women with severe preeclampsia, considering that it appears not to have a major hemodynamic effect in women with severe preeclampsia and that it uses a lower volume per dose than oxytocin, it should be considered a valid option in the management of third stage of labor in women with hypertensive disorders of pregnancy. As we know that the preeclamptic patients have a constricted intravascular compartment, we cannot then give them more IV fluids, and also oxytocin has an antidiuretic effect. Comparison with carboprost. Carboprost is second line. Carbetocin is first line. Not recommended as a first line. This is recommended by WHO. Yes, we know the side effects of carboprost. No such severe incidences, but I think carboprost has saved us over a period of years. Contraindicated in asthma, but can be used with caution in asthma. Okay. Then again, there is a comparison for the cesarean delivery as well as in patients with low risk and high risk, in elective cesarean, in high-risk patients, and in patients with twin pregnancy. It proven to be superior over oxytocin and other uterotonics with respect to prevention, estimated blood loss, need for additional uterotonics, decrease in hemoglobin levels, need of blood transfusion, perception of pain, and side effect profile. So there was a champion trial and heat stable versus oxytocin to prevent the hemorrhage after vaginal birth. Okay. And this is a trial carried out by WHO for carbetocin versus oxytocin. Even it was conducted in India across 23 centers in 10 countries, including India. Like it was conducted in Belagam, in Wardha, in Bagalkot. I know that it was conducted here. And these are the centers in India. Okay. Cuttack Medical College, then the Karnataka Lingayat, KLE, Belagam, I told you, Jawahar Nehru Medical College. Then again, the Bagalkot Hospital and Department of Obstetric and Gynecology, Lata Medical Research Foundation and Daga Women Hospital, Maharashtra, and Institute of Medical Sciences, Banaras Hindu University. Carbetocin proved to be non-inferior to oxytocin with ease of single dose administration. I'm happy to see this. Superiority of carbetocin over oxytocin was discussed in a conference in Bangalore in 2019. And I think Dr. Uma Pandey gave a talk about this carbetocin, and she said that there are some limitation of that and the storage facility, but what we are looking today at carbetocin is in India heat stable carbetocin, because we know that again we should not have the problems of storage. Okay, so composition, it is available as 100 microgram per ml solution for injection. It is indicated for prevention of uterine atony and excessive bleeding following delivery of the infant by cesarean or vaginal delivery, and it must be delivered after delivery. So cesarean section single dose should be administered as a bolus slowly over 1 minute after delivery. Vaginal delivery, it should be administered after delivery of the infant, again within 1 minute, just like oxytocin as a IV bolus, or you can also use it as a intramuscular injection. Okay, so we all learnt about its superiority over oxytocin, okay, and also about over the ergot alkaloids, again over all other compared to the other analogs as well as. So it is a most efficient uterotonic and was most awaited uterotonic, and it has arrived now in India. So dear friends, when we are talking about postpartum hemorrhage, all of us, we know an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. So we have to prevent, okay? So we have to be prepared. Once we are prepared, we have to prevent postpartum hemorrhage, because even ounce will definitely worth a pound of cure, was said by Benjamin Franklin, who was a founding father of the United States. And also remember one more quote from Benjamin Franklin. When we are talking about the drills and the simulation workshops, you know, that is, you tell me, I forget. You tell me, I forget. You teach me, I learn. But you involve me, I remember. So that is the importance of the simulation and doing the debriefing, because that will definitely go a long way to act in time, on time, to save the mothers of our country. Thank you very much for your patience.
Great. Great lecture by Sheila ma'am. Everybody is appreciating that. Over to you, chairperson.
And used as a prophylactic. We still do not have as a therapeutic drug. Okay. If we are using it as a prophylactic, I don't think there should be any problem, because it has the same qualities as oxytocin. Okay. And the advantage is it has a prolonged effect. So as it has a prolonged effect, but I think definitely I will have to look at some more studies, but as it is oxytocin, it should be safe. The company people should be able to.
Yes.
Okay, and the second question is, can it be given after 80 units of the oxytocin?
After
80 units of oxytocin is given already.
That is what I want to tell you, that we have still not, there is no recommendation for it as a therapeutic drug.
Yeah.
It is used as a prophylaxis. All the studies have looked at prophylaxis. So we are using it for active management of third stage of labor. Okay, I want to make it clear. Even in studies in India are also only for prophylaxis. And why for prophylaxis? Because the action is prolonged. It is 60 minutes. You are shifting the patient. You are worried, you know. You have to give the oxytocin drip. We are shifting the patient. But if we have given carbetocin, they say that it, you can, I mean, compare it with 40 units of oxytocin, which is given. That's what we learned. So I think one dose of IM will take care for a very long time.
One question is there, ma'am, from Dr. Manisha. Can carbetocin use as first line?
Yeah, first line only. What was the question? Yes, it is a first line only.
First line.
If we are using carbetocin, we are not using oxytocin. So it is available in Canada. It is available in Europe.
In India also it is available.
It is there in FIGO. It is there in FIGO guidelines.
Okay.
It is available in FIGO guidelines.
It is available as a carbetocin here. 340 rupees per ampoule is the price. And very effective. Sir, as Bhagade sir has joined. Bhagade sir, I request you for the closing remarks.
Somebody has asked for the maximum dose. Only once. The injection is given only once. 100 microgram.
Yeah.
Okay. Simple, so there is no question of maximum dose. As I said, it is for prophylaxis.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much for that elaborative and covering all aspects of PPH. It is a very important thing in practical life. Everybody must have suffered from this position who actually practice the obstetrics. Okay. Now I request Ashok Bhagade sir to give his closing remarks on Sheila Ma'am's lecture.
This is really very informative and knowledgeable lecture by Dr. Mani. I really appreciate this, because the carbetocin is available in Aurangabad now. It's last 8 of 10 days only. So we'll try it our level best, and we'll see, we'll make a record, and then we can publish a paper in Aurangabad also.
Yes.
We'll see it. A nice lecture, madam. Very nice lecture, madam.
Thank you.
See, we don't have to wait for
though I joined late.
Yeah.
But the last 10 minutes I heard, it was a really nice informative lecture, madam.
Yeah, there is a question now. If the patient is having PPH after carbetocin, yes, there is no guarantee. We are using it as a prophylaxis. Okay. If the patient continues to bleed, yes, we will have to give all other eutrotonics. We will have to do all other measures. Okay. So it is not that it is a permanent thing like we have given and there is no bleeding now. Okay. So I think we have to. The cost, I think,
340 rupees per ampoule. 340.
Okay. And according to their studies, what are the contraindications? I think as oxytocin, there are no contraindications. So there are no contraindications for carbetocin also because it is the same thing.
Same. Yeah. Thank you, madam. Thank you very much.
Dr. Somay Gowda wanted to ask a question. He has raised a hand. You can put it in the chat box, Dr. Somay Gowda. How to step up the dose? No question of stepping up the dose.
Single
dose.
Only
once. Yeah. It is only once. Okay? It is only once.
Ma'am, are there any studies about induction of labor?
No. It is only for post-delivery. That is why that is the advantage. We said when we are using oxytocin for induction of labor, it blocks the receptors. And then later on, when we give oxytocin, it may not be effective. But carbetocin is never used before delivery. It is only after delivery. So there is no question.
Sheila, ma'am, one question is there. What's the effect of carbetocin on heart as compared to prostodin, means carboprost and prostodin injections? Means if some anemic patient, if we will give, or some mild cardiac, mild mitral stenosis, all those, if we will
we
give
do carboprost, not give, yes, yeah. No, we don't give carboprost in them.
Exactly. Yeah, so can we give carbetocin?
Yeah. I think carbetocin can be given because it is an oxytocin. See, when WHO says it is a first line drug, and it is used for prophylaxis. Okay.
Because we're concerned with the heart load. Heart load will be increased after prostaglandins. That's why.
No, the action of carbetocin is a sustained uterine contraction. In carboprost, it increases the load to the heart. Somebody has also asked. Yeah, that's what. So about the carboprost also, we have certain limitations for Rh negative patients, isn't it? We think that it can cause a very strong contraction and we want to prevent. And in these cases, I think carbetocin will be more useful.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Now we move on to...
Dr. Ajay, one last message I want to give.
Yeah, ma'am. Please,
it is
please,
for yes. prophylaxis. It is please. Not for therapeutic.
Yeah, this is the 10th time you are telling that.
Yeah, because you know, the studies are also, because many people are asking about it. So I have to, because...
Ah, yes, ma'am. India,
yeah.
The person... Really,
this is prophylactically.
Yes, obviously. She has told in lecture also, it is prophylactic given once only. Thank you, madam.